بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الخلق والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We have just stopped yesterday before we before reaching, or we did reach just the subtitle on taqwa. So the thus far we that before taqwa we dealt with the fourth obstacle, the carnal soul. Okay, and we continue inshallah reading from the path of the worshippers Minhaj al-Abidin. So Imam Ghazali begins with another hypothetical question. فَبَيِّنْ لَنَا الْآنَ مَا هُوَ التَّقْوَى حَتَّى نَعْلَمَهُ. If it is said, describe the reality of piety and fear of God, so that we will know what to do. And to begin with, many Muslim scholars and probably non-Muslims too attempted to translate taqwa into English, and we have fear of God, being God conscientious, and it seems that taqwa is choosing the best possible course of action in terms of the hereafter, and that which is in your best interest, and as such it will be fulfilling all the obligations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has asked us to do. But in each case, the behavior of the taqwa is to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, always with sincerity, always with truth. So the answer came from Imam Ghazali rahimahullah. فَعَلَمْ أَوَلًا التَّقْوَى كَنْزٌ عَزِيزٌ. That to be God conscientious, to go through your life while remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and seeking His pleasure by, you know, through obedience. And the taqwa kanzun aziz, it's a rare treasure, a dear treasure, but really it's a rare treasure here. فَلَإِنْ ظَفَرْتَ بِهِ فَكَمْ تَجْدُ فِيهِ مِنْ جَوْهَرٍ شَرِيفٍ وَعِلْقٍ نَفِيسٍ وخير كثير ورزق كريم وفوز كبير وغنم جسيم وملك عظيم فكأن خيرات الدنيا والآخرة جمعت فجعلت تحت هذه الخصلة الواحدة التي هي التقوى. وتأمل ما في القرآن من ذكرها، كم علق بها من خير، وكم وعد عليها من ثواب وأجر، وكم أضاف إليها من سعادة. وأنا أعد لك من جملتها 12 خصلة. So the answer to the question, know that piety and fear of God is a precious treasure. If you can possess it, you will find in it notable substance, generous sustenance. Great treasure and abundant wealth. It is as though all blessings of this world and the next have been combined and contained in this single quality, which is piety and fear of God, taqwa. I suggest that you refer to and contemplate the Holy Quran and learn its benefits and the promise of rewards and felicity that it brings. I shall just enumerate for you 12 of those benefits and rewards. And since the metaphor is basically it's a treasure, taqwa is a treasure, and the probably the appropriate translation of Jawhar Sharif will be the jewels, which again in both cases we talk about an allegorical interpretation. So all the valuables will be there. All the valuables. The first one of these 12 benefits, rewards, attributes. أولها المدحة والثناء. قال الله تعالى وإن تصبروا وتتقوا فإن ذلك من عزم الأمور. So the first is God's praise, for he says, and if you are patient and God-fearing, surely that is true constancy of the steadfast heart of things. Have patience, have fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, beware. Yes. Number two, الحفظ والحراسة من الأعداء. قال الله تعالى وإن تصبروا وتتقوا لا يضركم كيدهم شيئا. تتقوا. Same. So the second is God's protection from enemies. What does God say? If you are patient and pious, God fearing, that is, their guile will never harm you. Will never harm you. Number three, because you are always seeking refuge anyhow, you seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you have no recourse to anyone, even if you have recourse to anyone, always remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala facilitates things for you. It's not about you, it's not about your ability. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends things and people your way. So number three is التأييد والنصرة. قال الله تعالى إن الله مع الذين اتقوا. قال تعالى واعلموا أن الله مع المتقين. So I have this presence. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's going on in details, because this is one of the issues where Imam Ghazali differed with the Muslim philosophers, where they said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the universes but does not know the particulars. This is absolutely unacceptable, and Imam Ghazali responded to them. So here we talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rendering his support to those people of taqwa. Yes. الرابع النجاة من الشدائد والرزق من الحلال. قال الله تعالى ومن يتق الله يجعل له مخرجا ويرزقه من حيث لا يحتسب. So the third is God's support and victory against your enemies. As God says, know that God is with those who do good deeds. Verily God is with those who are pious and God-fearing and those who are doers of good. The fourth one, النَّجَاةُ مِنَ الشَّدَائِدِ وَالرِّزْقُ مِنَ الْحَلَالِ. قال الله تعالى وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. So the fourth one is being saved from hardships and provisions of lawful sustenance, as God promised in the Quran. And he who fears God, God will provide him a way out. And he will provide for him from whence he never reckoned. Just think, Maryam alayhi salam. ويرزقه من حيث لا يحتسب. When Sayyidina Zakaria alayhi salam asked about the whereabouts of the food, because he was entrusted with bringing her food and provisions and what have you. But every time he came, he found that she already has plenty of food. He asked about the whereabouts of the food, of this food. She said, "Huwa min indillah." It is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that moment, Zakaria alayhi salam, though he's a prophet, he remembered immediately that he was really negligent of this address. هنالك دعا زكريا ربه. There, at that moment, immediately, Zakaria alayhi salam, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for offspring, not food, simply knowing the address. Yes, the force is being saved from hardships and the provision of lawful sustenance. As God promised in the Quran, and he who fears God, God will provide him a way out, and he will provide him from whence he never reckoned. من حيث لا يحتسب. Yes. Number 5, إصلاح العمل. قال الله تعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم. So the believers are addressed here, qua believers of course, and where they were asked to use what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided them with in order to fix things. إصلاح العمل قال الله تعالى الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم. The fifth is standing all your actions toward good, as God says in the Quran. O believers, fear God and speak the words hitting the mark, and he will set right your deeds for you. Yes. But it's really a window will open for you to be saved, inshallah. يجعل له مخرجا ويرزق من حيث لا يحتسب. The fifth is إصلاح العمل. قال الله تعالى الذين اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم. Number 6, غفران الذنوب. الله تعالى يغفر لكم ذنوبكم. So forgiveness, of course. Yes, healed. So the 6 is earning God's forgiveness as he promised. And he will forgive your sin. I'm not sure it is automatic just like this, earning. And of course, it's not an Arabic, but that's not why I'm reluctant to accept the translation in my head. So we have غفران الذنوب ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم. And then love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إن الله يحب المتقين. Allah subhanahu loves those who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have taqwa, who have fear, if that's exactly the only word in English, because fear is khawf. At-taqwa basically avoiding, pushing against disobedience, pushing against Satan, pushing against the carnal sin. The carnal soul, really. And number 8 is acceptance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّهُ يَتَقْبَ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Number 9, الْإِكْرَامُ وَالْإِعْزَازُ. قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِنَّ أَكْرَمَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ أَتْقَاكُمْ. Verily the most honored in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is your most fearing, the one who is God conscientious. It has been translated as the ninth is earning the friendship and grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As the Holy Quran says, verily the noblest of you in the sight of Allah is the most God fearing of you. So being honored, being dignified, إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. والعاشر بشارة عند الموت, good omen at the moment of death. قال تعالى الذين آمنوا وكانوا يتقون. The tenth is being blessed with good tidings at the time of death. As God says, those who believe and are God-fearing and pious, there are good tidings in the life of the world and in the hereafter. Number 11, النجاة من النار. قال الله تعالى ثم ننجي الذين اتقوا. The reference being saved from fire of hell, as God promised in the Quran, far removed from it, hell will be the righteous, and then we shall deliver those that are God-fearing, and the evildoers we shall leave here, hobbling on their knees. So number 11, yes. Yes. So 11 and 12 in English, the 11th is being saved from the fire of hell. النجاة من النار. قال الله تعالى ثم ننجي الذين اتقوا. We will save those who are God conscientious, God fearing. Far removed from it. Yes. Far removed from it. ثم ننجي الذين اتقوا. As God promised in the Quran. Yes. And then we shall deliver those that are God fearing and the evildoers. We shall leave here, or there rather. Hobbling on their knees. Certain things that I cannot find in the Arabic text, but I can read. Finally, the 12th is eternal life in paradise. الخلود في الجنة. قال الله تعالى أعدت للمتقين. Finally, the 12th is eternal life in paradise. As God says, a paradise as wide as the as are the heavens and earth, prepared for those who are pious and God-fearing. فهذا بيان كل خير وسعة في الدارين تحت هذه التقوى. فلا تنسى نصيبك أيها الرجل منها. So this is the description of all good and felicity that piety and fear of God, that is taqwa, brings you in this world and the next. So, oh brother, do not forget to take your share of it. I think this is very important. Do not forget your share. I think the idea is not to go into extremes. So as soon as هذا بين كل خير وسعة في الدارين تحت هذه التقوى الإنسان يصيبك أي رجوعها. Yes, do not forget your share. Three of all those benefits relate specifically to the affairs of worship. Affairs is God's support and help for God-fearing people, as the Holy Quran says. Verily, God is with the righteous and God-fearing people. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ التَّوْفِيقُ وَالتَّأْيِيدُ. يعني ثم الذي يختص بهذا الشأن من أمر العباد ثلاثة أصول، أحدها التوفيق والتأييد أولا وهو المتقين، كما قال الله تعالى واعلموا أن الله مع المتقين. Second one, إصلاح العمل وتم التقصير وهو للمتقين كما قال الله تعالى يصلح لكم أعمالكم. So restoring things, fixing things, completing things, making up for things, and this is really the trait of the of المتقين. They are the ones who are God fearing. كما قال الله تعالى يصلح لكم أعمالكم. Number three, قبول العمل وهو المتقين كما قال الله تعالى إذا ما يتقبل الله من المتقين. So the third is God's acceptance of your deeds. Concerning the pious and God-fearing people, God says, verily, God will accept the deeds of the righteous and God-fearing people. In other words, the foundation of worship is based on these three principles. ومدار العبادة على هذه الأمور, meaning توفيق and تأييد. Number two is basically إصلاح العمل وتمام التقصير. والثالث قبول العمل. So all action will be based on these three. التوفيق أولا حتى يعمل به. Concerning the pious and God-fearing people, God said, verily, God will accept the deeds of the righteous and God-fearing people. In other words, the foundation of worship is based on these three principles. ومدار العبادة على هذه الأمور الثلاثة التوفيق أولا حتى يعمل, ثم الإصلاح والتقصير حتى يتم, ثم القبول إذا تم. هذه الثلاثة هي التي يتضرع فيها العابدون الله عز وجل ويسألون فيقول ربنا وفقنا لطاعتك وأتممنا وأتمم تقصيرنا وتقبل منا, وقد وعد الله تعالى ذلك كله على التقوى. وأكرم بها المتقي سأل أو لم يسأل. So in other words, the foundation of worship is based on these three principles. First, that God helps you in your deed. Second, that he corrects your imperfections. So that third, so that third, your acts are accepted. So that your acts are accepted. These are the three matters in which worship or other worshippers seek and ask God, saying, O God, grant us success in worshipping you, and put an end to our faults, and accept from us our worship. Indeed, God Most High promised all those, for all these are retained for piety and fear of him. Yes. Oops. So when he says in Arabic, وَيَسْأَرُوفَقُوا رَبَّنَا وَفِقْنَا لِطَاعَتِكَ, O God, grant us success in worshipping you, and put an end to our faults, and accept from us our worship. Indeed, God Most High promised all these, in return for piety and fear of him, and honor servants with them, whether they ask him or not. It is therefore your duty to nurture piety and fear of God, taqwa, in your soul, if you want to worship God, or rather if you seek felicity in this world and the next. The Imam Ghazali mentions some poetry, really. First one verse, then three full verses, then again one on its own. So the first one, after he made a very short introduction, عليك بهذه التقوى إن أردت عباد الله سبحانه بل إن أردت سعادة الدنيا والعقبة ولقد صدق القائل من اتقى الله فذاك الذي سيق إليه المتجر الرابح. He who fears God and is righteous shall soon have turned to him enormous profit. Yes, enormous profit. It could be also like a profitable business. Then again, Imam Ghazali mentions three verses here. من عرف الله لم تغنيه معرفة الله فذاك الشقي ما ضر ذا الطاعة ما ناله في طاعة الله وماذا لقي ما يصنع العبد بعز الغنى والعز كل العز للمتقي. He who knows God and God's knowledge does not make him feel rich. He is a wretched man. What does God's servant think he is to do with the glory of wealth? True glory is for the pious and him who fears God. He who worships does not lose what he attains from worshiping God and that which he sees. So the first verse, من عرف الله لم تغنيه معرفة الله فذاك الشقي. He who knows God and he is not satisfied by this knowledge of God. This is the wretched person. Then he said, مَضَرَّ ذَا الطَّاعَةِ مَانَ لَهُ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ وَمَاذَا لَقِي. What does God's servants think he is to do with the glory of wealth? I think this is a problematic translation. True glory is for the pious and him who fears God. He who worships does not lose what he attains from worshiping God and that which he sees. So that's the one that was really problematic. What does God's servant think he is to do with the glory of wealth? I think it's the accurate translation will be what does God's servants what does God's servants think he is to do? True glory is for the pious. والعز كل عز للمتقي. He who worships God does not lose what he attains from worshiping God and that which he sees. That which he receives, the order of the verses is not the same. What he receives. Yeah. Then Imam Ghazali mentions one last, of course, here in this context, one more verse separately. وكتب على بعض القبور. I saw this poem, this verse was written on some graves. So على بعض القبور إلى على قبر. On a grave. ليس زاد سوى التقى فخذي منه أو دعي. There is no provision except piety and fear of God. Then take this from me. Or say farewell. ثم تأمل فصلا ثم تأمل أصلا واحدا وهو هب أنك قد تعبت جميع عمرك في العبادة وجاهدت وكبت حتى حصل لك ما تمنيت ليس شأن كله في القبول وقد علمت الله تعالى يقول أنا متقبل الله من المتقين. Moreover, contemplate one principle. Even if you spend all your life in worship, struggling and enduring hardship in the hope of realizing your goal, the outcome of all these will be contingent on God's acceptance. Indeed, I know that God Most High says, I know, you know. It's not وَقَدْ عَلِمْتُ, it's وَقَدْ عَلِمْتَ. Rather than I, it's you. Indeed, you know that God Most High says, Verily God will accept only the deeds of the righteous and God-fearing people. Yes. فرجع الأمر كله إلى التقوى لذلك روي عن عائشة رضي الله عنها أنها قالت ما أعجب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بشيء من الدنيا ولا أعجبه أحد إلا ذو تقى. There are several problematic. It is problematic this hadith. And there are several problems. The first one, it is a weak hadith. Number two, it does include Ibn Lahiyya in the chain of narrators, who was really a saduq. He used to say the truth in the sense he would not lie against Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Those who circulate false traditions, knowingly, that's serious issue. He did not. And Ibn Lahiyah really originally from Hadramaut in Yemen, and he ended up being a judge in Egypt. There was an incident in which his books, Ibn Lahiyah's books, were burned down. There was a fire. And they said that he started mixing up things thereafter. Second problem, to deny that Rasulullah ﷺ had ever liked anything except that someone who is really pious. We know very well that there's a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that he loved you know, a woman, and he loved good perfume. We know also that he liked, you know, to eat from the shoulder. That was not a daily thing. And Sayyidina Aisha Anha, they spent 40, but 2 months really in a row. They did not have anything except water and dates, laswadain, except that when one of the neighbors would send some milk for them to drink. 2 months in a row. And we talk about reducing calories today, and we talk about all kinds of diets and intermittent fasting, and all this fasting that they did at the time was, you know, in a sense, it was very, very hard for them, of course. Yeah, so Rasulullah did like certain things in this life. Yes. وعن قتادة أنه قال مكتوب في التوراة ابن آدم اتق الله ونم حيث شئت. Once you have taqwa, then you can sleep anywhere, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is protecting you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, all this is, but yes, one has to have that cornerstone. Taqwa is cornerstone, it's the prerequisite. Taqwa is, because people could do things without taqwa. And Imam Ghazali mentioned those in Kitab al-Jah, or yeah, that they might compromise even their salah, just improve their own salah in order to be accepted. And this is directed at people, not at, directed at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's really shirk if it's really wholeheartedly for the sake of someone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a very important issue, and we need to stop here, inshallah, and we'll continue with Nazjal tomorrow or after tomorrow. Subhanakallah wa hamdik. نشهد أن لا تنسى خفركم وتبليك. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.